morning. It's Wednesday the 18th of January 2017. Now, we mentioned many, many times on this programme, although we don't talk about it really, Celebrity Big Brother and the trashy television that you and I have to put up with today. Well, gang, it's not just the programmes themselves. No, I have discovered it is also the audience that watch them. They're as bad as the people on the telly, dear. Look at this. In this morning's Superway, Soraway, Daily Mail. And remember, if you see it in the Daily Mail, it must be right, dear. Emma Willis is booed. Emma Willis, now you know Emma Willis now. She's a very good presenter. I do get sick and tired of seeing the same presenters on programme after programme after programme. As in particular, it's her, Emma Willis. I've got nothing against her. She's a good presenter. But why is she presenting virtually all the programmes, along with the lovely Philip Schofield, who I like very much? Throw a programme at him and he'll be able to do it fine. And Ben Shepherd, it's three of them. We keep seeing them time and time again on the same things. He's on there, Vera's on there, she's on there, all over the place. Can we have a little bit of variety? I mean, I am available. You know, I think I should start off with a quiz show. Something like Chris's Celebrity Squares. Chris's Golden Shots. Chris says Opportunity Knocks. What do you reckon? Chris Ridden's Blankety Blank, 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 Blankety Blank. Yeah, I could do that. I could do a quiz show like that. One of the older ones. Not the new ones. Not the new ones. What's that one with Ben Shepherd where the coins are there being pushed forward? Just like a giant thing at the seaside. You know the sort I mean. And the coins fall off, don't they? I'll give a demonstration. I shall demonstrate this with two batteries. Yes. Here we go. Right. So the machine goes to the light and you drop another coin. I haven't got any coins with me. That's why I'm using batteries. You drop another battery on, right? And the machine pushes it. And you win a prize. I could do that. Anyway, back to this story. Look at this. She's been a top draw as the show's presenter since 2013. But on Tuesday's instalment of Celebrity Big Brother, Emma Willis managed to turn some of the show's audience against her as she attempted to censor Jasmine Waltz. Now, what does she do, Jasmine Waltz? I never heard of her. Who is she? Anyway, conducting an interview with the recently ejected housemate, the lady was lambasted by fans for telling the outspoken model to... Oh, she's a model. To curb her language. They've turned on her! Following the unceremonious eviction through a side door over the weekend, the model returned. She model. Now, the thing is she a proper model or is she one of them that gets the old breasts out? Because to me, that's not really a proper model. You know, that's just getting the breasts out for the attention, isn't it? I mean, I could do it on this programme. Do you want me to do it now? If I was to get my breasts out, I would immediately... The ratings for this particular worldwide television phenomenon known as United Kingdom Talk would go through the roof. They would. But I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that because I'm a little bit more conservative, shall we say. You know, I don't need to get breasts out to get attention, dear. I don't need to do that. True to her fiery self, this Jasmine, I've never heard of her. Is there a picture of her somewhere? Oh, that's her, is it? This, well, okay. However, it seemed the presenter was told to rein in the 34-year-old language as she apologetically tackled the actress on her swearing. Interrupting Jasmine, Emma asked, "Can I just ask you quickly? We want to hear what you have to say, but can you rein in the language? We are used to seeing it, but if anyone's offended, I'm really sorry." They always say that on the telly. As Jasmine apologised for the swearing, an audible boo, boo, But I get that a lot when I've sung a song at the karaoke, funnily enough, booing. An audible boo was heard coming from the crowd outside the studio, presumably directed at Emma's unusual chiding. And it seems fans of the show at home were just as irked by the censorship as many took to Twitter. Oh, please. I mean, they're just as bad as a bloody show. Are you a Celebrity Big Brother watcher? You love that, do you? People swearing and screaming at the programme. Please. Honestly. Is there any decorum or politeness at all now in this world left? I think this is the only... Even Radio 4, you hear swearing on Radio 4. This is Radio 4. And now the 1 o'clock news. Beep. 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 Or if it's a leap year, beep. There's an extra bit for you there. Is there any decorum and politeness in this world anymore? My Lord. Now, obviously, I didn't know this until I read it in a paper because I don't watch trash television. I don't, although I was watching a little bit while I was having my toast this morning. I had to have toast this morning. I've run out of bran flakes and porridge. Can you believe that? I meant to go to the shop on the way home last night. Oh, that's another story coming up in a moment. So I had toast this morning and I had a bit of Jeremy Carlum. And it was this, youngish woman, bright pink hair. You know, bright pink hair she had on. And she's sitting there accusing the boyfriend. Here's another example of a nasty audience again. Accusing the boy. I will turn on everyone. I will. Accusing the boyfriend of sleeping with someone while he went out to the shops or something like that. Right? So it cut to the boyfriend. And I immediately knew, you're not guilty, mate. You could just tell. You know, you get the Jack the Lads that come on like this. Oh, no, I'd never have done that. And you know they're lying, as proved by the lie detector test. Beep, 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 beep. That was an impression of a lie detector test. I hope you enjoyed it. At no extra expense. So then they call him on. As he walks on, he's got quite a gentle walk to him. You know, none of this. No, he just walks on. And the audience were booing him as he came on. You know, assuming him guilty before even anything's happened. So he came, and as soon as I thought the audience is wrong here. And so they brought him on and he had a little bit of a chat. And he was very calm and very collected. And I could just tell that he wasn't lying. Anyway, the questions that Jeremy was asking, some text was read out or something. Jeremy was asking him and he was answering them. And then Jeremy turned round and to the audience says, who thinks is guilty? And virtually everyone put their hands up. Virtually everyone. And then the lie detector test came back. He was telling the truth on all counts. And then the audience start clapping. I mean, how pathetic are you lot? You're disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. You automatically assumed he was guilty. That's really pathetic. And then when he was innocent, they all clapped their hands. They really are pathetic, some of these audiences. Where are they coming from? Where is the Celebrity Big Brother audience and Jeremy Carl audiences? Where are they all coming from? Dreadful, ghastly people. Ghastly. It really is. Dear, dear me, I'm so glad that there are no viewers to this programme that are involved in anything like that. So there we are. So last night on the way home, as I was saying, I had breakfast this morning. I had to have toast this morning. I went out last night. I had a nice day yesterday, actually. We went swimming in the morning, me and my mate, and then we went to John Lewis. He had a grey jacket to take back. I think that is that Andy, his boyfriend, has ordered online, and it came in a post with a hole in the back. Not like an unstitched hole, but an actual hole in the back of the jacket. So we had to take that not to John Lewis, to Moss Brothers, who were very good and changed it instantly. We had a little bit of dinner out. Where did we go yesterday for dinner? Ask, which is like Italian stuff. And I had spaghetti. Now, they didn't have my favourite spaghetti arrabbiata or whatever it is. I can never say the word. Spaghetti arrabbiata. So I ordered normal spaghetti. And I said, you don't have spaghetti arrabbiata, do you? And Ronnie says, oh, could you put some chilli in that for him? And he said, OK. So I didn't think anything of that. And he had some pizza, like a chicken pizza thing. Chicken on pizza don't sound right, does it to me? Does it to you? I don't know. Anyway, so that's what he had. Mine arrived. Well, I took a mouthful of this stuff and nearly blew me head off. And I looked and there were bits of a chopped up chilli in it, but not cooked. My mouth was so hot. It was like fire flames were coming out of my mouth yesterday. So I had that along with two large pots of tea to try and wash it down. Actually, you know, here's the weird thing. You know, I get a bit of that acid reflux stuff. Nothing at all after that. Now, you would think if anything caused it, it would be something spicy like that, wouldn't you? But nothing. Nothing at all. Not the tiniest bit of acid reflux, I think. So we went from there. We went to Moss Brothers to change that jacket. That happened quite nicely. We were going to go to Ed's Diner for one of their very famous, very, very tasty vanilla thick ice shakes. But it was closed. It's a little sign. Closed due to unforeseen circumstances. But it looked like that had been a permanent thing. I don't know if that's closed. That's the Ed's Diner in Reading. Now Reading is like the main town near us. Not a place you want to hang around. Ghastly people walking around outside. Dreadful, dreadful. Jeremy Carl audience people type walking around the streets of Reading. There really are. So we went then from there to John Lewis. Now there. He bought me a Google Chrome for Christmas. It was one of two presents, that and a pair of shoes. But I don't need it. I can stream stuff from my mobile phone through a little Apple TV thing, which I've had for about 5 years. I think it was one of the first things to come out. One of the first Apple things to come out. But I only use it, really, to stream stuff from my mobile phone into my television. So he took that back to swap it with something else. And I had a look around. I had a look at chairs. Now, you may remember I've been telling you about this. I'd like a chair in my living room, electric one, where you push a button and the legs come up and you go back down. A bit like on British Airways business class. Oh, yes. And the legs come right up and you push it and it comes down. Oh, we're looking at that. Do you know... And I know the one I want. I can't part with the money. How weird is that? I thought it might be in the sale, but it wasn't. It wasn't in the sale. It's not a particular thing. The weird thing is they've got a settee, a double settee, which would actually work out cheaper than buying the single chair because the double CD, the double settees are a special buy. But I haven't got room for another double settee. You know, I've got room for one, just one armchair, zzz, 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 like that. I've got room for one of those. So to actually buy a single chair kind of relatively works out dearer, but that's how it'd have to be. And I've sat in this chair for about 10 minutes, and they don't force you to buy anything in John Lewis, you know. You're not hounded by anyone. And in the end, I got up. He said, did you order it? I said, no, I can't part with the money. And we walked out. And from there, we went to Apple. Because I'm looking at these iPhones, dear. I'm still looking at these iPhones. And I've been in Apple now four times. Four times I've been in Apple. And how much is this? Or what does this do? And I know all about this phone. And once again, I walked out. Nope, couldn't buy it. Couldn't bring myself to buy it. I'm terrible. I don't know what's happened to me. I've got worse like this. I think, like I said to you, I think it was on last week's show, I've got mortgages. And I can see where I want to be at this time next year. And it's easily achievable if I put my mind to it. And that's what I want to do. And I think that's what's stopping me spend money. I really do. I want to knock these on the head before that interest rate goes up. Because it's coming. The interest rate's not ever, it's not always going to be really low. It's coming. So I'm trying to knock down these mortgages before it goes up to make myself a bit of room there. So that was great. Came back here. I was really tired when I got back. Had a sleep for a while. Got up again. I went down into London to wish my friend. My friend had a little bit of a birthday drink. And I'm off Tuesday nights, as you know. So I went into Hammersmith. Oh, it was bloody cold last night. Oh, you know, and first of all, I had trouble parking. I had to park, oh my God, you know, 10 minutes walk away from this pub, which was, what was it? Be at One in Hammersmith. Parked the car along this road. Which, the first time, it had four of those electric charging posts on the road. Mine is not a plug-in vehicle. It's petrol electric, but you don't plug it in. And I've never seen four in a row, and they were all occupied by various different cars. And it's a weird thing, because there's a wire coming out of the post. You know, the post that's in the ground. There's a wire comes out of that, and you plug it into your car. And I thought, how easy would it be, you know, to take a pair of scissors, well, not scissors, but, you know, cutters, and simply go around cutting the wires? You know, someone will do, I'm sure that's probably happened at some point. You know, in the same way that people, jealous people, you know, put scratches down cars or let tyres down or things like that. You can see someone coming around and, you know, four in a row, they'd have a whale of a time. Cut, cut, cut. Unless there's something within that wire. I mean, it doesn't look like there's any metal in it, but there might be something in the wire, I suppose, to stop that happening, would it? I don't know. Don't know about that. So I walked from there down to the pub, which was Be At One in Hammersmith. And it's quite it's a dark place, actually. You walk down, it's almost like a corridor, and it kind of opens up at the back. And there were three youngish bar people there, and my friend Rodney, we were there, and he was pleased to see me, and I was pleased to see him. There was a friend, John, and Scott, and I met Ashley. Who else I met? Tracy, who I hadn't seen for a very long time. She used to come to the karaoke when I did karaoke at Blues in Hammersmith some years ago now. And it was all very nice, although the music was a bit loud in there, dear. Bang, bang, bang. Oh, I thought, please turn. Can't go down, you know, because it's a young, you can tell it's a young person's bar. And I'm thinking, I wish they'd turn the music down. Either that or put some Barry Manilow on, you know. Excuse me, have you got any Barry Manilow? Eh? You can just see him now, can't you? So it was all very nice. And I got home, got back here. And then on the way home, I thought I'll stop at the BP garage on the A30. And I needed some shopping, breakfast things and things like that. I'd almost run out of soya milk. I have soya milk. I've gone back off the gold top now because I've been watching YouTube videos about how badly cows are treated. Yes, in farming, dairy farming, as well as meat farming. Terrible, terrible. So I've dumped. I'm trying to dump all the dairy again now. And I tried to get onto the M4, and there was a queue a mile long trying to go around this roundabout. I thought, oh, they've closed up, blooming overpass off. So then I was very lucky. I was at the end of the queue, and, you know, you could either go there to the M4 or there to the M3. And I was right there, and I indicated, and fortunately, a kind driver let me across his lane, so I was able to go down there. I thought, I'll go on the M3 and then M25. M3, M25, A30, right like that. And as I got to the end of the M3, not only had they closed the M3 at the M25 junction, but they'd also closed the M25, which is the usual divert to get back on there. I thought, oh, God, so how can you close two of those roads at the same time? Stupid people. So what I had to do then was go left onto the M25, get to the Woking roundabout, go round that and then back onto the M25, past the M3, which was closed, and then onto the round again like that, and then onto the A30 like that. So I got there and I went in there and I got my milk, but I don't have any breakfast cereal in here, unfortunately, so I wasn't able to get that. And then went to bed, and then here we are this morning. That's it, you see, here we are this morning. That was my day yesterday. Now, it is, talking of Barry Manilow, it is very, very important this morning, boys and girls. Today, Barry Manilow's hit single, Mandy. Oh, Mandy, well, you came and you gave... Sorry. Oh, Mandy, well, you came and you gave without taking... Oh, we love it. We love it, dear. Well, when he does that at the concert, it starts, he disappears off the stage. And it starts, a big video screen comes down. And it projects him singing Mandy when it was a hit in the 70s, you see. And that's on the big screen. And him as the young man, you know, an original video of him on, oh, what was the programme? Like a Top of the Pops type thing in America. So that comes on and he does a verse and a chorus. And then Barry comes on the stage and sits at his grand piano on the stage and then joins in with that. And it's all very clever. All very, very clever. Well, today, as informed by the great Wendy, good morning. Just to let you know, if you're doing a show today, Barry's first hit, Mandy, was number one in the charts. It's 42 years ago today. 42 years ago, it was da-da-da-da-da-da, Britain's number one. Yeah, 42 years ago in the charts today. Gives you a reason to talk about the disc. Yes, the disc, as given to me by Rachel and Anne and donated by the lovely Eloise. Eloise. I love your name, Eloise. I love, love, love that name, Eloise. So there it is on my wall. That, as signed, let me just touch this. As signed by Barry himself, that is a Barry Manilow signature. Not available to be sold. Thank you very much. That will always be on my wall. Some people, they collect things for money, don't they? You know, they think they can collect something and several years later sell it at a bit of a profit. But that will always be on my wall. I hope it will always be on my wall. I've actually got some sets of records as well in my in the cupboard there. I think there's a Michael Jackson box set I've got there and a Whitney, possibly a Whitney Houston box set, or Mariah Carey, one of that lot. Yeah, I've got two box sets of records in there. Oh, why don't you sell them? No, they're nice to keep, aren't they? They're nice to keep, these things. So there we are. How are we doing? Oh, look at the time. 21 minutes we've done. Good God, 21 minutes already. Now, just one other little story I wanted to do. Ex-England footballer, BBC presenter, Hollywood actor and X Factor star fear sex tapes will leak after Amir Khan's X-rated video is posted online. I mean, why do they care? Who's bothered? They're all doing it now. God's sake, a group of British male celebrities are said to be worried that their X tapes will leak after Amir Khan's X-rated video was posted online. Now, when I saw, I mean, have you seen Amir Khan? Oh, dear. Good looks. Wow. How good looking is he? I could only dream of being that good looking in my sad, lonely, pathetic. He is drop dead gorgeous. No wonder they wanted to make a tape with him, dear. No wonder. Insiders told The Sun that videos have started to be released after a collector of celebrity X tapes. Celebrity Busted was hacked. Celebrity Busted has become notorious for its collection of pictures and X tapes of famous men that have collected over the years. A tape of Amir Khan carrying out a X act while speaking to a female model on Skype was released earlier this week. I mean, I think that there's some of these girls are setting up these things, aren't they? They're setting up Skype things and doing stuff with people on the camera. I mean, it's not even as if they were touching each other. It was a video link. I mean, God knows what you lot are doing while you're watching me sit here, chat away. I perish the thought of thinking about anything like that. Oh, and it goes on, you know. So I don't know who else has made one. But there's a couple of things here, I think. Number one, don't film yourselves. What is the excitement? I don't understand the excitement of going as a Skype, for example, going on one end and you're on that end and there's no physical touching involved. What's all that about? Just, you know. What's all that about? And number two, you know, I'm not convinced that they will all be released on there. Now, I've had a tape on there for years, you know, and I've not had any views at all. I don't understand that. Do you love it? Why have I not had any views? Poor old Amir Khan. And besides, lads, I wouldn't worry about it. I really wouldn't worry. No one's worried. It's going to make no difference to you at all. Absolutely. What would bother me? What would bother me is if I had one of those, what are they called again? One of those tapes. What, well, they're not really tapes, are they? They're movie files, whatever you want to call them. But if I had a tape up there, what would bother me if, number one, I had children and my children found it? You know, because this stuff that they put online doesn't disappear. That's there forever. That's there forever. Or number two, not as bad. My mother and father found it. Can you just imagine having one of those tapes online and either your children, years later, or not necessarily years later, they find it on there, or your mum and dad find it? Come on. It's nothing to be proud of, putting yourself on there. It's not art. Oh, it's my art. Oh, please do me a favour. It's not art. Art is lovely pictures, not like at the Tate Gallery. Lovely pictures drawn and painted. That's art. Art is not doing it on the video. That is not art. It's not. But Amir, don't you worry. And Amir, I think he's just got married, has he? Amir, if you get dumped by your new wife because of this, my phone is available for you to talk to. Oh, hi, Amir. Yeah, it's Chris. Yeah, pop round. Yeah, pop round. No, don't worry, no cameras. Poor old Amir. Let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls. Happy birthday this morning to the lovely Timothy Thomas. Happy birthday, Tim. Timbo. I can't believe how old you are, dear. I'm 54 next month. God, happy birthday, Tim. Happy birthday to Paula Pure, who I haven't seen for ages and ages. Lovely drag queen that I've worked with over the years. Not recently. I haven't seen you for ages. Happy birthday, Paula. Happy birthday to the lovely Chantel. Chantel, my darling, who I worked with at Belushi's in Hammersmith. And I had a lovely time there with you. Happy birthday, Chantel. Happy birthday today to Adam Lee. All right, Adam, 33 today. Bobby Rocking. DJ Bobby Rocking. What a fantastic name. I think that is your stage name, isn't it? Bubs. Bobby Rocking. Barbie. Oh, that remind me of Dallas. Oh, Barbie. Barbie. Dallas, yes. Happy birthday to Mark Monroe. Is that a beard you've got now, right? Oh, I don't like beards, Mark. But you're younger than me. Now, Mark was the first, or one of the first gay DJs I ever came across. And I used to go in, it's where I work there now on Thursdays, but I'd never really been in gay pubs much. And I used to go to this place, the Two Breweries in Clapham, which is still there. And I work there Thursday now. And Mark was the DJ there, and he was gorgeous. Standing there in a little Levi's jacket and Levi's jeans. I remember Mark playing wonderful music for us to dance to in that very dark, dingy club where I was never chatted up. I must be so ugly. People never chat me up, not even then. When I was 28. Happy birthday, Mark. 50 today. Happy birthday to Angie Florence. Happy birthday, Angie. To Mark Rabjohns, 55 today. We're all in the over 50s, aren't we? Happy birthday to Barigye, Vincent, Kompany. And happy birthday to David Paul. They're the birthdays today, gang. Oh, where's my music? There it is. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Now, being Wednesday, it's quiz night tonight. Join us this evening at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington. It's every Wednesday. Starts at 8:30, finishes at 10:30. Two rounds of questions, a picture round and a music round, all right? There's a £30 bar tab up for grabs. That's the first prize. Second prize is a bottle of wine. Every Wednesday, the King's Head Theatre quiz night. Join us this evening, 8:30. Get there about 8 o'clock if you want a table because it gets really busy, or even better, ring ahead, okay? Apart from that, have a nice Wednesday. And thanks very much for watching and listening. Leave a little message under here and I'll read them out on the next show. Oh, I haven't read... Actually, I didn't read... yesterday's messages, did I? How rude of me. Just a moment. I better just go back on that, because people are good enough to leave messages and things like that. And I do feel that I need to read them out. So where are we now? There we are. Kiki D says, my nan, we were talking about nans, weren't we? My nan always had a little bottle of whiskey in her bag. We would find her empties as cupboards and behind the sofa and in bushes all along our street. How wonderful. Great fun. It was like an Easter egg hunt for us children. And we would sip the bit she left over. Oh, I don't know, Kiki. I don't know if I'd want to drink out the same bottle as my nan. I'm not... I'm sure about that. Thanks, Kiki. John says, maybe the neighbours near the school gate should get a handbill. We're talking about noisy schools in school in Islington. No, not Islington. Notting Hill, where the parents were complaining about the noise of the children. And John says, maybe the neighbours near the school should get a handbell and ring it. Ding, ding. When the kids get too noisy, then they will think it's time to queue up and go inside. I like that. I like that. I've got a bell. There's a school over there, and I have done that. And you watch them, they start queuing up. Joanna says, I haven't received the Christmas star you sent yet, but post from the UK usually takes 3 weeks, which of course, what Rosemary told us that as well. I'll let you know when I receive it. Also referring to nans, my nan used to carry chocolate Hershey, but oh, I don't like Hershey chocolate. Oh, it's vile. You come and try some English chocolate, Joanna. Hershey chocolate bars in her purse for us children, so we knew to be good. Gosh, what sweet, sweet memories. Oh, that's lovely. That's lovely. Hello to Simon, who says, back of the newspaper for women. Can you send me the ones you used, please? How dare you? I haven't used any from the back of the newspaper, but it wouldn't be girls anyway. Not yet, anyway. Simon says, lonely me, no dear. And Katie Price, no thanks. She has dropped more flies than a bug zapper. Trust me, I'm not lonely. I do okay for women, Simon says. I do not have a little black book. My book is massive. I'm sure it is. I said book. My book is massive. I'm sure it is. John says, as your karaoke nights have become more successful, it makes sense for them to be starting earlier. However, a 7 o'clock start may be too early for some people, especially those who work. As it may be there that there will be no slots for people to sing as they arrived at 8:30, as other singers have put a low... No, just because you put a stack of songs in, right, that doesn't give you priority over everyone else. However, you will, of course, by default, sing more songs because you've come in earlier. You couldn't have, say there were five singers who came in at 7 o'clock. It wouldn't go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way through. You would be slotted in. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 6, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 6, 4, 5. So it depends when you come in. Just because that's not how I run it. You can't get there and put in 100 songs and be the only singer all night because you got there first. No, it wouldn't work like that, John. Wouldn't work like that. But if you came earlier, more than likely, the people that came earlier would probably go home. Well, they do, for example. For example, Ray Reynolds, our good friend Ray Reynolds. He never stays till the end. You know, and if he came earlier, which would suit him, actually, he could sing another 2 songs, probably, and get 4 in, whereas you would probably get 3 in if you came later, you know, so there's no difference there at all, right? Simon also says, you like Let It Shine this Saturday. My pal Dan Budd from Stoke is on it. Robbie Williams tribute act. He's fantastic and a nice kid as well. Oh, I'd like to see him. Is there any videos of him, Simon? I quite like tribute acts. They're very good, some of them. Some of them are dire. Oh, they're awful. But some are really good. I've got a very, very good friend, Keith George, and he does Boy George and also some other characters he does now. But his tribute act is Boy George, and he is excellent. I mean, he's really, really good. Look him up on my friends list if you want to. Keith George, or type in the Boy George Experience and you'll find out all about him. Oh, that was a long show today. Gonna go now, boys and girls. Don't forget, King's Head Theatre Bar, quiz tonight, 8:30 every Wednesday, right? Have a nice Wednesday. Cheerio.